Good morning, Stephen Whiteside here, broadcasting from the wind tunnel this morning. It's Thursday, July 18th, 2013. We're coming up to 8 a.m. on the East Coast, and stock index futures are flat, so we are looking for a quiet open Thursday morning at 9:30. Now, I've previously mentioned that we're on a summertime video schedule, so videos just Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. But next week, taking a long weekend, and our offices will actually be closed on Monday and Tuesday. We will do a site update Tuesday evening, but the next time I'll be doing a video is next Wednesday morning. So we'll do videos next week, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. And hopefully it'll be a little cooler next week than it is this week. Now, this week we've been focused on the potential double top in the U.S. stock market. Still have not been able to break out above 1687.50. We're just under 7 points away from that level this morning. And since we're trading just around unchanged, it doesn't look like we're going to try to test that level at the open. Overnight, no major changes in the Pacific Rim markets that I follow. The Australian market's still trying to break out above 5,000. The New Zealand market's trying to break out above 4,609.38. We've got the Hong Kong market struggling at to break through the April lows. The Shanghai market ran back up to test the big down day that we had a couple of weeks ago and has not been able to break out above that level. Looking at the Japanese market, looks like we might go up and tag 15,000 before the Japanese market runs out of steam. Of course, everyone's still focused on the yen. The yen had an inside day yesterday, but still looking to see if it's going to change direction. It's basically been treading water for the last few days. Of course, a lower yen would be supportive for higher stock prices in Japan. Next up, let's take a look at the commodity ETFs, and starting with copper. Copper's been pretty spastic the last few weeks. We're back in the channel right now, still on a buy signal. We're in a tight range here for the last month and looking to break out above 39.06 and stay there, but unfortunately that's not happening. We've got an open gap that the market has run into, and that's acted as resistance so far. Looking at the GLD, a close below 121.77 would give us a sell signal on Thursday. Not a lot of love for the precious metals at the moment. We're stuck at 125, trying to break through above that. Then we've got an open gap. You'll also see that on the silver chart, so that's a major band of resistance. Silver actually generated a sell signal on Wednesday, so we need to get close up above 1911 on Thursday to give us a new buy signal. Don't think that's going to happen. And kind of strange, it looks like the public's giving up on the precious metals right now. We were hoping the pros would come back and take control, but that didn't happen, and now we've got the public giving up. And again, just like the price of gold, we've got a nice big open gap there that's a big wall of resistance. Both the bottom and top of that gap is going to act as resistance on the way back up. Looking at the energy ETFs, we've got crude oil with an early warning signal up there, but no sign of a pullback so far. A close below 36.50 would give us a sell signal on Thursday. I don't think that's going to happen. Inside day for gasoline on Wednesday, we're getting pretty close to where the market peaked out in March. If it takes out those highs, then we're looking for a move up to 65.63, which is up at the February highs. And unfortunately, nothing going on for natural gas on Wednesday. Now, I'm going to be away from the computer screen for a couple of days next week, and really the only numbers I'm going to be concerned about when I come back is, well, what's the VIX doing? If the VIX is still below 1514, I'm not going to be concerned about the market. If the VIX for the NASDAQ 100 is still below 1508, I'm not going to be concerned about the market. Now, those levels will continue to drop over the next few days, but really, you know, if the VIX for those two markets continues to trade below those levels, I'm not going to be overly concerned when I get back. Now, bonds actually generated a buy signal yesterday, so this could be the start of a new up move for bonds. You see the nice big open gap there. There could potentially be resistance. Of course, an up move in bonds will put downward pressure on rates and could be helpful to any of the interest-bearing or dividend-bearing securities out there. And you can see that rates peaked a few days ago, and so we're starting to see money flow back into those things, and we'll take a look at utility stocks in a minute. The major indexes, starting with the Dow, we can see we're up at the top of the panel. panic zones. We've got an early warning signal up there, so we are expecting a pullback here, but it has not started yet. Bank stocks still fueling this rally in the overall stock market. We're looking at transports here. They had an inside day. Utilities had an inside day. You can see they've moved up over the past week or so, and that has certainly been supportive for the overall stock market. Now, if you were an economist and you saw the price of crude oil where it is, you would probably have a very negative picture for the airline industry. And of course, that industry seems to be doing fairly well right now. You'd also have a negative view of the auto industry. And these are the two best performing sectors yesterday, airlines and autos. And both of them don't seem to be too fazed by the high price of crude oil and gasoline. Taking a look at the worst performing sector yesterday, that was the golds. They had a pullback to the upper trend line, but certainly no major breakdown just yet. Next up, let's take a look at some of the NASDAQ most active, and Yahoo had a huge day yesterday. It's actually traded above our projected range, and it's also done that on the weekly chart. So we can do math. You can just calculate the difference between these lines and add them, and that'll suffice until this chart recalculates a new range. But if we look at the weekly charts, you can go back to the highs from 2008, and that's up at $30. So this that $30 level might actually be a magnet for Yahoo. Taking a look at Dell, it was in the news all yesterday, and nothing going on with the price of Dell. It's now it's on a sell signal at the moment, going down to retest the recent lows. Sirius Satellite Radio had an inside day on Wednesday. Two stocks in the news this morning. Intel's down in the pre-market last time I checked, and we've got IBM up in the pre-market. IBM actually ended Wednesday on a buy signal, so it's going to trade up 320 last time I checked, but that, of course, could change by the time the market opens. Now, when you're looking between two technology stocks like this, you know, which one do you want to trade? And if we go to the flypaper channel, just visually, you can see how wide the channel is. That's a pretty nice channel. I would trade that stock. If you look down below, the average true range is a percent. Don't worry about the dollar amount when you're comparing stocks. You can worry about the dollar amount after you've picked your stock that you want to trade. Just keep that as a reference. But obviously, the most important number is a percentage. And so the average true range right now for Intel is 2.27%. If we compare IBM, you can see just visually how wide the flypaper channel is. So it's a big fat stock. It's a slow moving elephant. And the average true range is only 1.54. So this is not a stock you'd want to trade. Sure, you can play options on it if you want some leverage there, but you wouldn't want to trade it, you know, unless you're a portfolio manager and you want a big fat stock like this in your portfolio. And again, just visually, you know, if you look here, we were down at 180. We moved up to 215. So that's the same as moving from 18 to 2150. If we go back and look at Intel, you can see we moved from 19 all the way up to 26. So, you know, much different stock. And certainly Intel would be a lot more tradable. You'd get more bang for your buck than if you put the same amount of money in IBM, trying to trade IBM. Looking at Microsoft, had a little pullback to the upper trend line yesterday, no big deal. Micron, just a penny away from generating a new buy signal on Thursday. And Tesla got downgraded on Tuesday, got really whacked on Wednesday, a nice big reversal. Tesla's still on a sell signal, though, but on a long-term basis, we look at the weekly charts, and you really need to start breaking down below $100 before long-term investors will be phased on this stock. Last up this morning, quick look at the 60-minute charts. The first sign of weakness on Thursday is going to be an hourly close on the VIX above 14.13. We're looking at the daily charts, and just above 15 is where alarm bells would go off, and that's certainly the same picture we're getting on the hourly charts looking at the hourly flypaper channel. S&P 500 up at the top of the panic zones, projecting lower prices right now, but that has not happened yet. We're in a tight range here, looking to break out, as I mentioned before, 1687.50. If we start breaking down below 1671.88, that would certainly tell us something new is happening. But coming into Thursday, the first sign of weakness is going to be an hourly close above 1678.11. Okay, folks, that's all for Thursday morning. That's all for me from this week. Next time you'll hear from me is on Wednesday next week. On Wednesday, I'll do a Canadian presentation. Next Thursday, I will do a U.S. presentation. Thank you very much for your time. Thanks for all your feedback and support, and we'll talk to you again next week.